Thank you for coming, everybody. I'm Anita Rogers. Thank you for coming to the gallery tonight. Barry Schwabsky has curated this beautiful show that we have hanging at the moment. I'm sure you'll remember that. And I know Barry, that you take a question here.
Okay, yeah, actually, I'm playing role.
Thank you so much to Anita, everybody here, gallery, Elizabeth, for having this event during the show. Thank you to Barry, who created the show and invited and thought of doing this event. The event is based around, in some way, this edition of Blind Man, 1917, published in New York, edited by Henri Pierrochet, Beatrice Wood, and Marcel Duchamp. We have an esteemed group of people here to read a little bit from the edition, from the facsimile edition, from the magazine, to chat about its relationship to the present, and its particular quirks. I'm just going to read quickly bios of people who are here in front, and then we'll try to do it in the order that we're presenting. So obviously, Barry Schwabsky, the curator of the Divine Joke show, art critic for the Nation, author of several books, poetry and criticism, including Trembling Hand, Equilibrium, and Heretics of Language, both from Black Square editions edited by John Yao, and the perpetual guest, Art of the Unfinished Present, Verso, from Verso. Sophie Seita, who worked with Ugly Duckling Press to edit, compile, and frame this edition, this facsimile, is an editor, is a junior research fellow at Queen's University of Cambridge, working on provisional avant-gardes, little magazine communities from Dada to Digital, forthcoming from Stanford University Press. She writes poetry, translates contemporary German poetry, and makes performance that performances that visualize and embody text via sculpture, costume, installation, choreography. Next up after Sophie will be Christopher Stackhouse, a writer and author, writer and artist, author of Plural from Townpath, co-author with John Keane of Seismosis from 1913 Press, contributor to Basquiat, The Unknown Notebooks, and he's currently working on a monograph of the work of painter Stan Whitney. Myself, I'm Matvei. James is going to be next. So, James Hoff, artist working in painting, sound, writing, and performance with a strong focus on distributed forms, experiments with language, and cross-disciplinary investigations into computer viruses and earworms. He's the co-founder of Primary Information, a nonprofit arts organization devoted to publishing artist books. I'm sure you are all familiar with your work. It's a pleasure to have James here as well. And then I will read a short piece. I'm one of the editors at UDP, and actually have poetry out with John Howe's Black Square Editions. And lastly, we'll have John Yang. Oh no, I missed. How did I do that? Diana Hamilton reading before me, I think. Director of the Writing Center at Berkeley College and the author of two books of poetry and several chapbooks. Her next book is called God Was Right, forthcoming from Ugly Duckling Press. John Yang, poet, art critic, professor of critical studies at Mason Gross School of the Arts for Rutgers University. His recent books include monographs on the work of painters Thomas Liskowski and Philip Taffy, both from Lund Humphreys, and collections of criticism, The Wild Children of William Blake, and poetry, recently Bijou in the Dark, Letter Machine Books, poet and critic, and it's a pleasure to have John here. So without further ado, I'm going to pass it on to Barry, and Barry is going to introduce things, and we start our reading from the magazine.
Thanks, Matvei. And actually, I just have one more name to toss out. As you've probably seen if you arrived a little bit earlier, it's an exhibition of six artists, and most of them don't live in New York and couldn't be here. But of the two who live in New York, one is actually here among us, and he didn't want to be on the panel, but I understand that Rafael Vega will be making some remarks from the Peanut Gallery sometime after we've finished up here. So I want to thank Rafael for his beautiful paintings and for being here with us. And also, I should thank Anita for inviting me to curate an exhibition here. I thought it would be interesting, given that opportunity, to do a show of some artists whose work I think hasn't been seen sufficiently, or in some cases really even at all, in New York. To bring in some new things for people to see and discover. And as I was trying to figure out how to articulate what it was that made me want to put these artists together instead of some other ones that, you know, are also interesting that I could equally have included, somehow it was enormously helpful to me when I started looking at this this facsimile edition of The Blind Man that Sophie has edited and that Matvei and the others at Ugly Duckling Press have published and made possible, and in particular the text from the poet Mina Loy that that I take the title from. And in a little while I'm going to read the text, but I think what I want to emphasize, because people have sort of asked me about it, it doesn't constitute a theme that that I tried to make the exhibition illustrate. It really somehow articulates an attitude that resonated with me in terms of, one, how I felt about putting the exhibition together, and secondly, what I understood the attitude of the artists themselves to be in making their work. And the idea of the divine joke to me is somehow related to the idea of an affirmative acceptance of the absurdity and nonsensicality of our existence. And I've just been trying, kind of racking my brains, trying to read the book After Finitude by the philosopher Quentin Meillassoux, and it's a very difficult book, but his basic idea is that the only thing that's necessary is contingency. So there's this paradox that the ultimate ground of reality, if you want to call it that, is precisely that everything can be totally different and might be totally different from one moment to the next, even though we seem to see that everything continues as though that's not the case. And somehow I think that sooner or later you have to face that possibility and think that, wow, what a funny joke. Nobody's even played on us. I was going to say that God played on us. No, you know, there's nobody playing on us. It's a joke that's on us without there being any author of the joke. You know, maybe in the end the artist would disagree with my ascribing that kind of recognition to them, but that's something that I get out of their work, this kind of lightness and sort of joy, really, in accepting of any reality. Another thing that some people asked me about, or were kind of puzzled about, was the fact that this reference to Loy and to the blind man is something that goes to sort of the circle of Marcel Duchamp and New York Dada in 1917. And, you know, it's not that I chose works that are evidently Dadaist in inspiration or that are, you know, Duchampian works in any obvious sense. There are no ready-mades here, for instance. It's mostly painting, and one artist has photographs. You know, why do I have that reference? And well, fundamentally, the reason is that I think it doesn't really matter anymore that after 100 years, the point of the ready-made and of all the rest is with us in everything that we do, even if it's in a very conventional sense a painting, exists and is made within a framework that started 100 years ago, really, with the independence. And I forget who it was, probably Matvei, you can remind me, some famous writer, maybe it was Dostoevsky, said that all the Russian writers came out of Gogol's overcoat. And, you know, if you don't mind, I can say maybe all contemporary art was flushed out of Duchamp's fountain. And just to prove that that an artist whose work has nothing evidently Duchampian about it can recognize this, I thought I'd just read a little bit from a text that probably a lot of you know. It dates from 1951, and it's a talk that that Willem de Kooning gave at the Museum of Modern Art, and it's called "What Abstract Art Means to Me." And I'm just going to read one little bit of it, but he talks about movements in art and how he doesn't want to be part of any movement. And then he says, "Well, of all movements, I like cubism most. It had that wonderful, unsure atmosphere of reflection, a poetic frame where something could be possible, where an artist could practice his intuition. It didn't want to get rid of what went before. Instead, it added something to it. The parts that I can appreciate in other movements came out of cubism. Cubism became a movement. It didn't set out to be one. It has force in it, but it was no force movement. And then there's that one-man movement, Marcel Duchamp. For me, a truly modern movement, because it implies that each artist can do what he thinks he ought to do. He or she, we should probably say it, but couldn't say he. What he thinks he ought to do, a movement for each person and open for everybody." And I think that's really kind of a wonderful and fascinating statement about Duchamp, but particularly the fact that he says it's a one-person movement, But then, it's not our one person movement, it's everybody, it's everybody's movement. And there was a different panel discussion with a couple of the same people, oh, when was it, 2 weeks ago at CUNY. And there was a lot of discussion about the anonymity of, or pseudonymity of Duchamp's fountain, and who really is the author of that work. Is it Duchamp? Is it Baroness Elsa Freytag von Loringhoven? Is it somehow the group of people around them who also wrote about the work and so on? And I think I can say following de Kooning, is it everybody somehow? So that's the reason for my sort of choosing this text to give the title to the show I put together. So I'm going to read Mina Wise's text. It's called In Ellipsis Formation. I do not suppose the independence will educate the public. The only trouble with the public is education. The artist is uneducated, is seeing it, capital letters it, for the first time. He can never see the same thing twice. Even she, says he, terrible. Education is the putting of spectacles on wholesome eyes. The public does not naturally care about these spectacles, the cause of its quarrels with art. The public likes to be jolly. The artist is jolly and quite irresponsible. Art is the divine joke, and any public and any artist can see a nice, easy, simple joke, such as the sun. But only artists and serious critics can look at a grayish stickiness on smooth canvas. Education, in recognizing something that has been seen before, demands an art that is only acknowledgeable by way of diluted comparisons. It is significant that the demand is half-hearted. Let us forget, is the cry of the educator, the democratically simple beginnings of an art, so that we may talk of those things that have only middle and no end and together wallow in gray stickiness. The public knows better than this, knowing such values as the under-inner curve of women's footgear, one factor of the art of our epoch. It is unconcerned with curved fawn's legs and malign twirl scarves of artistic imagining, or with allegories of life with thorn-skewered eyes. It knew before the futurists that life is a jolly noise and a rush and sequence of ample reactions. The artist then says to the public, poor pal, what has happened to you? We were born so similar, and now look. But the public will not look. That is, look at the artist. It has unnaturally acquired prejudice. So the public and the artist can meet at every point except the, for the artist, vital one, that of pure, uneducated seeing. They like the same drinks, can fight in the same trenches, it's 1917, pretend to the same women, but never see the same thing once. You might at least keep quiet while I'm talking.
I'm going to read a couple of sections from the first issue, and it's the editorial statement, what we could also call maybe a manifesto, though it's not called a manifesto. But it's numbered, so it shares some of the features that we might associate with a manifesto, proposing a group sense, a kind of identity for the magazine, putting forward some aesthetic and political ideas about their work. So one, the Black Man celebrates today the birth of the independence of art in America. The Black Man will be the link between the pictures and the public, and even between the painters themselves. He will give voice to the enlightening opinions that may spring up and make them known to all, as impartially as he can, whatever be their tendencies, as long as they are interesting. He will give to lovers of art the pleasure of thinking aloud and hearing others do likewise. He will give to those who want to understand the explanations of those who think they understand. The blind man's procedure shall be that of referendum. He will publish the questions and answers sent to him. He will print what the artists and the public have to say. He is very keen to receive suggestions and criticisms, so don't spare him. Here are his intentions. He will publish reproductions of the most talked of works. He will give a chance to the leaders of any school to explain, provided they speak human. He will print an annual index for poetry in a supplement open to all. He will publish drawings, poems, and stories written and illustrated by children. Questions. Which is the work you prefer in the exhibition, and why? The one you most dislike? The funniest? The most absurd? Guesses. What will be the total number of visitors? The number of pictures sold? The highest price paid for a single picture? The lowest? The total amount of money paid for all the work sold? Suggestions. Write about the index or about any special work in the exhibition. 10, a dramatic story of less than 100 words. 11, a comic story of less than 100 words. 12, a dream story of less than 100 words. 13, a quatrain or a limerick. 14, a song, words, and music. If a painter shows you a picture you can make nothing out of and calls you a fool, you may resent it. But if a painter works passionately, patiently, and says, I am making experiments which may, perhaps, bring nothing for many years, what can we have against him? Then, I mean, this goes on for a really long time, but the one important statement at the end. Russia needed a political revolution. America needs an artistic one. That's it.
Which one? So I chose three different writers out of the group of magazines. Walter Conrad, Ahrensberg, Frank Groenshield, and Beatrice Wood. I chose Beatrice Wood because of longevity. You know, I thought it was a really interesting thing to think about an artist who lived to be 105, started writing in her late 80s for the first time. Something else that was interesting for me about her specifically as an artist is being someone who is working with her hands, being a potter, working as a ceramicist, the attentive level of the level of attention that she could give to that kind of plasticity, and in a very focused way, like vessels, among other things, to be able to turn that creative mind over to writing and write in a very loose way and have a certain command of language that allowed her to be playful with it and observe art and art ostensibly and outwardly, also observe art's effects on the mind and with humor, I thought was pretty interesting. So I'll read one of hers. And then Ahrensfeld, he was just the ultimate kind of weirdo in a way, as a poet, critic, following that tradition. His poems somewhat reminded me of my own poems, and I wondered if that was an effect of working both as critic and poet. And trying to service both of those things at once, observations about art that are somewhat abstract and theoretical, while at the same time trying to make an artwork about a poem. So I'll read a couple of those. And then Frank Groenshield, I'd never heard of him. And when I realized that he was an editor for Vanity Fair early on, that was a real surprise. I don't think of Vanity Fair as a literary magazine I barely think of it as a cultural magazine. So very, very surprised to discover that its point of birth was actually quite radical. And given this magazine or set of magazines, to think about these or this work, or this material here, in relation to what Vanity Fair is now, is kind of an interesting thing to think about. So I'll read something from him as well, which is just a letter. The first thing I'll read are Ahrensfeld's, Walter Conrad Ahrensberg, his poems. There are two. The first one's called Axiom. From a determinable horizon absent spectacularly, from a midnight which has yet to make public a midnight in the first place, incompatibly copied the other in observance of the necessary end guarantees, the simultaneous insularity of a structure self-contained a little longer than the general direction of goods opposed tangent tickly. His word. I think he meant tangentially, but that's what it says. Yeah, tangentically. And then there's a poem here called Theorem. It goes, for purposes of illusion, the actual accent of two waves transparent to a basis which has a disappearance of its own is timed at the angle of incidence to the swing of a suspended lens from which the waves wash the protective coloration through the resultant exposure to a temporal process. An emotion, ideally distant, assumes on the uneven surface, descending as the identity to be demonstrated, the three dimensions with which it is incommensurate. And then I'll read Beatrice's pieces. Two from her, and I like these two pieces also for the title, titles of them. They both refer to a picture hanger, work of a picture hanger, and dream of a picture hanger. And as someone who has art handled and hung almost every contemporary artist in New York's paintings that paints, I thought it was hilarious to just read this, thinking about some of the thoughts I've had holding some of the worst and some of the best paintings available. Work of a picture hanger. I have dragged pictures across the floor for hours. I have heard hammers for hours. And I have felt icy drafts for hours. And this is the independence, the day before, bare walls with pale canvases lined at their feet. Occasionally only are the faces to be seen. Once I deliberately turned up a Severini, and its warm pink tints seemed to cheer me into promises of what might be. Then the smell of wet glue, mentally, I was not spelling art with a capital A, and the mess of trying to remember the alphabet correctly 400 times. It was fairly simple till we came to the Smiths, about eight and all, but we no sooner decided they belonged to one place than someone placed them in another, and for an hour every time we moved a picture, it turned into a Schmidt. With a sigh, I would drag heavy framed canvases along the floor. When I stopped, I would look if it was all right. Kabah! And away I would chase for another. If not, well, imagine straining your back over old maids' sentimentalities or pictures of blue-eyed girls caressing goldfish. I did not press long. I did not dare. Too many overalls. However, I played about some children's canvases, but as I left eyes circled and dizzy, I heard a voice say, "That Schmidt, doesn't it look fine?" And I ran. I can relate to that one. And then dream of a picture hanger. Mildly more serious. I was walking in the Independence along the row of the S's. I tried to walk to the ends, but I fell over and into canvases, and each time my foot broke one, I hid it behind a picture of Mark Schmidt. I came to a doorway, and the doorway became obstructed with large canvases with heavy gold frames. I began to move them, and I felt my back breaking, and each time I looked for the name of the artist, I saw Schmidt. It made me so mad, I took the whole pack, which I had with such difficulty moved, lightly on my head and began running. I ran in and on and over walls. Once I jumped into a picture and sat still looking like a Chinese god while men passed. I am worth $800, I thought, and I laughed. And that was a piece of soap. With nails on my back stuck on the canvas, a big flood came and swamped all the first floor, and the canvases began whirling on the ground. Blue arms and green legs floated past, and I said to myself, those are the art critics. As I was a piece of soap, I too must melt. So I flung up my arms wide, and I was on a high, high pedestal, looking deep down onto the destruction, and some tiny black man was climbing up to save himself. And as he reached my wing, I bellowed, who are you? And he answered, I am, but the rush of the waters drowned in his voice, and I woke up. And then the last is the Frank Cronin shield, which I just have a hard time believing that he was serious. But then, you know, as I look at it closely, I guess he was really serious when he wrote this. And I'm wondering if anyone today writes letters to magazine editors that are this earnest. Dear blind man, fine you. You are, I hope, to be an instrument for the accomplishment of an important and much-needed work in America. Namely, the fostering and encouragement of a truly native art. An art which will be at once the result of a highly vitalized age, of a restless artistic spirit, and of a sudden realization on the part of our artist of America's high destiny in the future of the world. Such an art must very closely embody the spirit of our time, however morbid, however hurried, however disorganized, however nerve-wracking that it may be. Abba, you should say, with any and every school of art that represents another day, another spirit, another time. No art can live that is not an integral part of its time. Put Botticelli in a studio on Fifth Avenue, put Corot in a garret in Washington Square, put Fragonard in a barn in Harlem, and their work would be worthless, sterile, of no lasting purpose or power or of evocation, because it would fail absolutely to symbolize and synthesize the spirit of our age. Their work would merely be something promoted not by our life, not by the vitalized forces of our time, but something promoted only by the flat, dead, and profitless spirit of a bygone time. So, if you can help to stimulate and develop an American art which shall truly represent our age, even if the age is one of telephones, submarines, aeroplanes, cabarets, cocktails, taxicabs, divorce courts, wars, tangos, dollar signs, or of desperate strivings after new sensations and experiences, you will have done well. The future dwellers upon earth will then be able to look back to your day, to our day, and with truth and conviction say, yes, they had an art back in New York in the days following the Great War, an art that was a vitalized part of their life, that mirrored accurately their time with all of its complexities, graces, horrors, pleasures, agonies, uncertainties, and blessings. admiringly yours, Frank Cronenshield.
All right, I'm going to read the Ridgefield Gazook, parts of it. It's a little, is it technically a magazine or is it a pamphlet? How would you guys describe it?
I guess because it wasn't even published and it was only really distributed by hand, there was only the one copy. It was handed out to a community of writers and artists. So. But I feel like if it's in the spirit of the magazine, there might have been more issues.
Yeah, I was going to ask if there were, but Man Ray, it was definitely 1915. Okay, so it's like one of the things that's actually true on this. I was remarking to Matvei earlier about this work because it reminds me so much of a good friend of ours, the poet Julien Poirier, who edited a newspaper called New York Nights and was one of the first poets I ever worked with, or the first poet I ever published, Matvei being the second. And it sort of has the same style, which I really like in a way, because when I think about Man Ray, for instance, I think of him, I know his work isn't completely austere. I think of his work as very austere because sort of history has sort of filtered it that way for me. So it's interesting to look at these magazines, and it's great to see them back in the public, so people can actually access them, so you can sort of have maybe a different entry point into the larger body of work of the artist, in particular Man Ray. So, as Matvei mentioned earlier, I'm a publisher as well, and so I'm going to just read the cover and the back cover of this. People say you can't judge a book by its cover, which I kind of don't actually agree with, so, but at any rate, I'll leave you guys something to desire. You'll get the insets if you want to pick it up. Is this available for...
On its own.
On its own, so at the merch table, after the topic. All right, Ridgefield Gazook. We are not neutral. Number 0, March 31st, 1915. Published unnecessarily whenever the spirits move us. Subscription free to whomever we please or displease. Contributions received in liquid form only. This issue limited to local contributors. Editor Man Ray, Ridgefield, New Jersey. On the cover is a illustration of two grasshoppers, I believe grasshoppers. Did you say grasshoppers? Enjoying each other's company very much. Underneath, it's the title of the illustration is The Cosmic Urge by Man Ray. With a little side note, with apologies to one of three people, either PK Ass O, or Pi Ass, or Picasso, which I think is kind of written in a way you can't really quite make out the K, the I, or the C. And the O is really, really small. So. At least I gave him credit, you know? That's nice. On the back cover. To Him, by Autumn Law, or Autumn Latt. There's sort of a little T that's flying on the page here. So, this is a song, Words Without Music. Hallelujah, hallelujah, glory to cornstalk, he destroyeth all evil, he destroyeth all art, hallelujah, I'm. And then there's a little illustration, which looks like a little Rorschach test, or a little paint splat, or an ink spill. What do you think? What do you see when you look at this? And it's titled Art Motes. But is this a play on a French word? What else? Does anyone know?
Well,
I don't speak French.
Words.
Yeah. There we go. signed by Come Off. With a K. All right, notice, the survival of this publication is not guaranteed unless adequate support is forthcoming. May all remonstrances in the form of money orders or cash payable to Man Ray, P.O., Ridgefield, New Jersey, single copies, 50 cents.
One of the
Octavia's poems and this Medusa. Sinister Rape. Oh, I thought I said Spinster Rape, which is why I chose it. It doesn't. Sinister Rape. Dexter Left. Superior Hypocrisy. Spirits Without Light and Not Here This. Art Starboard. Red and Green Fort Without Vessel. Why Change Men into Animal Feti? My tongue becomes a road of snow. Circles are formed around me. In bathrobe, exterior events, Napoleon, modern ideas, profound artists reunited in canon, who deceive, artists of speech, who have only one hole for mouth and anus. I am the lover of the world, the lover of unknown persons. I am looking for a son. And this is a letter from a mother, according to the blind man. Letter from a mother. I have never been in Europe. I was born in Minneapolis, and I am the mother of three children, all gifted, two exhibiting in this exhibition. I have always felt nervous about artists, but in my modest way, I am a believer in democracy. Therefore, as a woman who has done her duty toward the race and experienced life, I make the plea to all other mothers and women of constructive comprehension that we keep this exhibition sane and beautiful. It is only by elevating the soul and keeping the eyes of our young ones filled with lovely images that we can expect good results from the generation that will follow. People without refinement, cubists, futurists, are not artists. For art is noble, and they are distorted. Independence is needed, but a line must be drawn somewhere. In sincere faith, I hope for your success. Sincerely, a mother.
So I'm going to read a piece of Mina Loy's, or the credit says compiled by Mina Loy. It's called O Marcel. Otherwise, I also have been to Louise's. And as Sophie has pointed out in her essay, she writes about this, about the collage nature of this text that's seemingly taken from conversations had in this circle at maybe the editorial meetings or drinks after parties, which I'm sure became the other.
It was probably the blind man's ball.
Oh, it was probably a blind man's ball.
Yeah,
for which there's a poster in the edition by Nicholas Wood. Okay. I don't like a lady in evening dress salting. From here she has black eyes, no mouth, some... Will you bring a perfection? Well, bring a bottle. Two perfections. Well, I want to see it. He will know it afterwards. Will you bring the bottle? Really, have I? Which way? Oh, did I? When? Too much? You were abusing myself. No, you would not. Did you ask the moose about it? Anything you like, would I? Oh, now, of course not. Yes, I do. I used to kill myself with the siphon. You don't remember that ball? Well, don't do that because I am perfectly sober now. That's the kid who looks like. It will probably cost me very much. I have not got money. Did I say I wanted the bottle all right? See it. Excuse me, explain it. You don't need any. I will give you some paper, Mina, and keep silent to give you a rest. Oh, I will give you some paper all the same. Very much. He said to me, we will toss whether you resign or I resign. A very old French story about the English man must shoot first. She has a pencil in her hair, very impressionistic. You know, you should have some salt on your hair. It's so nice. Because? Nothing. It's music. Ah, this is it. Do not worry about such things as lighting a match. I give you my key, Clara. Hey, have some yellow paper. If carried away, if Clara ever returns it. Well, you did about a week after. Here's the salting lady. I will show her to you. Salting lady. She passed. Do not speak anymore. You have to squeeze it, made of the I used to go every day, waitress. I feel ashamed in front of this girl. She looks at me from far. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. Yes, have a drink, lady, teaspoon by teaspoon. No, please take this. Do I eat? You know why I have one. I do have it. I want some tongue. I will give you some, but don't do too much. What? Suck it. Well, I don't know how I will get up early tomorrow. I have a lesson at 2. No, not with the bell mare. You don't know what a wonderful sensation it is. I have some preference for some company. Where is our waiter? Where is he? It sounds it, doesn't he? Mina, are you shorthand? I never knew it. I want a tongue sandwich. Anyway, it keeps me awake. You know, she comes riding school, 56th Street. You know she comes. Lunch, 12 o'clock. Well, you know it was. How do you light a cigarette? How do you light a match? Did you, well, it is not dangerous at all. Did you got it? Are you an American representative? I am sorry. You are Pennsylvania. I am Boston. Do you want some cigarettes? Do you put the pronunciation? Waiter, tongue sandwiches. Do you want hot milk? Two perfections. She doesn't want anything. You got it? She can't write it down anyway. Through the flag, oh, some cigarettes. Waiter, I want some cigarettes for Mina. This is a wonderful tune. Tilis lilaire Mina. I give you $2. It means to me $2. Tilililera. It is twice I need to shave now. Demuth, you must be careful of your key. She keeps it about a week. Every key she gets, she keeps. You speak like Carlo. Well, when he wants to imitate, well, have a drink. You know, those two girls are crazy about that man. They mustn't. You must get him out. I will have a tongue sandwich. You must suck it. Censorship. Don't let your flag get wet. Is that Billy Sunday? One should have had an additional star, Billy Sunday. There is always a sky in heaven. That is too low. My ancestor is tall people. Don't write. He is going to leave you for a minute. Sandwiches. Oh, I forgot to telephone. What shall I say? Tilililera, she said. All right.
Touch and feel plaster, it's like the day.
Right. Yeah, this is Rhonda Penton, and the scene is that she is looking out a window while he is reading Polish letters by Michel Duchamp. It's cold, isn't it? What a dreadful night.
Yes, you're always right.
It's cold and dark. Oh, look at the pretty little twins in the garden.
Are they playing?
Yes, they're playing.
Oh.
Look at the pretty twins in the garden.
How many?
4.
Male? Female?
Both.
Oh.
Look at the little twins in the garden.
What are they doing?
They're making love.
How annoying.
Isn't it? Are you done?
No.
Well then, it's the exquisite hour. I love you.
The little twins in the garden?
What do I?
And then I'm going to read one poem. If I can find it, it vanished.
I think I was initially in 2-1.
Yeah, it was the rubbish.
Here
it is. So everybody's told me how they got their choices. They all selected it, but I thought in the spirit of Duchamp, I would leave it to others to decide what I should read. So it's a chance operation. A Resolution Made at Bronx Park by Robert Carlton Brown. I'm going to get a great big feather bed of a pelican and keep him in the house to catch the flies, mosquitoes, and mice who lay eggs for me to make omelets of and be my downy couch at night.
Okay.
how to proceed to a coherent discussion. Maybe that would be a big mistake.
Incoherent discussion in any case.
But, you know, I think it's... it's interesting that we all seem to find that this material from 100 years ago, there's something that seems so of the moment, and I don't really know how to describe that or to explain why we wouldn't probably feel in just that same way about something from 120 years ago, you know, the late 19th century. It does seem that there was a kind of change culturally, and I wonder whether anyone has a kind of fast, off-the-cuff summation of what that could be.
The place I was thinking of turning from is, it's always the opposite, like what doesn't resonate? And I think that what does and doesn't to me in all these readings is this, like, the fantasy of democracy throughout this project. The sense that there is, that by giving up certain aesthetic criteria, being open to new forms, there could be an actually open art world. And even the fantasy that it's time that legitimizes work and not power or institutions or money. Even the sense that there's something so neutral as the present moment. I mean, imagining now someone claiming that we want to have a work native to America that was describing these artists is wild. Just imagining titling a show The Blind Man and have it not be remotely a question of ability or disability is strange to me, right? So the which wasn't to say, like, to throw it away, but I do think that to read these sort of, like, longings for a New York where art would be as legible to a mother from Minneapolis as someone from the art world, and to imagine that that's what's being instantiated, and to look back at how that is not what was brought into being. Is there an interesting moment of it?
But that itself still seems, I mean, you can say it's diluted, but it seems very current to me in some way. I mean, in the text that Sophie was reading, where this invitation was kind of put out saying, you know, just send us whatever you think and we're going to just funnel it out there and kind of circulate it for you. And I thought, oh, you know, they wanted the social media before social media. There's this, you know, that sense that, you know, anybody can put their post up on Instagram or anybody can put their post up on Facebook, and we're not going to censor you, of course, you know, on Facebook and those things they do. And in the Independence exhibition, as Duchamp proved, likewise, as the mother from Minneapolis said, there was a line that had to be drawn, and it was the line that the fountain was on the other side of, but yet there was, yet no matter how many times we have it sort of proven to us that inequality is sort of built in, if there's no sort of neutral device of expression of everything, we still want it. We seem to kind of want it more now, even or in different ways, at least, than then.
Yeah, I don't. I feel like I'm put on the spot because as the editor of the issue. I mean, I think I was actually thinking that you were also referring to the form or the aesthetics of the work that, when you speak to us, will resonate or seem very contemporary. And I mean, I think that it's obviously a sense of, like, syntactic openness or fragmentation, but suddenly, like, you know, the realization, oh, you don't have to write poems in this particular form. But even just, I mean, the reason I read also that editorial statement, these suggestions, I think, again, they gesture forward to maybe some conceptual art of fluxes, or conceptual writing, or kind of these instruction pieces that we can take an invitation to kind of work around a particular concept and then run with it, or a constraint. I think that's really why it's also, it feels very contemporary. But yeah, I mean, I think it was right what you said about that there was a particular moment that was instantiated with modernism that we're not quite past. Yeah.
This, also the idea of publishing a magazine is something that can be distributed. I mean, when I came to New York, I went to the Poetry Project, and I still have piles of mimeographed books. I have students that don't know what a mimeograph machine is, and when we printed them, it'd be like 10 people walking around picking up a page and putting them on the next one until it was done. You know, there'd be an edition of 300, and somehow 300 people was all it needed to be. There didn't need to be more. That seemed the whole world was 300 people. The rest of the world didn't exist. And I still think that's probably true. And Sid Corman, in Origin, only would limit it to 300. And he said the readership never got bigger than that. But 20 and 20 gets a little depressing, but not completely.
Well, it's the difference in thinking about what is a like a web, or what is a world. Like,
right.
Is the world 300 people? Maybe it's that's the world that you can actually, the amount of people you can actually discuss things with, meet, you know, personally to some extent, or have some contact with in person.
Yeah.
And in a sense, that doesn't really change over, you know, in terms of our capacity to actually have exchange with people, that doesn't really change with social media, right? We just, it's a phantom of growth, right? But you're right, like those 300 people, and the way that the blind man was distributed, and the way that it created a history of itself, you know,
right.
Just two issues, and staged the whole so-called scandal, which it created around the fountain, which wasn't a scandal until it got published in this little magazine. And then they made a big deal of it. Or they probably, like, you know, some of those pieces, like the piece of my mother, is obviously fabricated in order to create this idea of
a faux controversy.
A faux controversy, and also a reach of, like, this people that someone from Minneapolis brought. So I don't know. Just it's interesting how that small world actually makes this huge, you know, is a central moment in our history now. And it was really the blind man's ball couldn't have been more than 100 people,
yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
And the readership couldn't have been more than a couple hundred.
Yeah.
It was true. A seminar in California when Walls Vernon did it, he basically. Wanted to hand the magazine to everybody, right? So it's again, I think, an edition of 300. And he starts it because the show is closed down by the police. And then he never shows again, and he starts this magazine. But it's a pretty outrageous magazine. And then years later, George Herms does a facsimile edition because he loved it so much. And love Wallace so much.
I mean, and the blind man was also mostly distributed by hand, and there's a, both in the ritual of the zook, there's this joke about censorship, and also in the Beautiful Audience, I mean, this was real, like a real threat, like that, they couldn't be sent out in the mail very easily.
Right.
I think also, like, pulling back from maybe just like a wider view of the sort of role of the magazine within that sort of group that we're talking about, like not so much about the blind man, but the other magazines as well. It's like, and what we're kind of all talking about, it's like the magazine becomes like a bonding agent for communities that carries like a role, well, it can be like kind of like a ledger in a way, like for later on in life, but it can also be like an entry point for someone to enter into a community of writers or artists, and obviously it can be a platform for a lot of, be a platform for like groups to actually sort of publicly discuss or think about their project or their project relationship to the larger world. And I think that that's still really strong these days. And Anita wrote Fluxus, and Fluxus was started from a magazine, basically. And publishing was integral to what they were doing. And they were openly coming to be Dadas in 1962 and 1963. They abandoned it pretty
quickly. Yeah, they also use different titles, or like sometimes maybe the title is spelled differently. And then also again, here, I mean, VV, trail, I mean, you don't have to say it, but.
Yeah, no, it's also like, I think that humor also is a really nice agent of familiarity within these documents that we can sort of also like relate to and draw a line to. I guess it helps if it's sort of like bad puns and stuff like this. Like they kind of never grow old, I guess, you know. So I said all the puns were the same in the, like, in the 1915 as they are now.
The thing that I keep thinking about is between then and now, and I think across the 100 years, the century, is how artists deal with power. And you know, thinking about looking at this stuff, there is a background of all the conversation is a kind of it's not a kind. There are actual power relationships that have and can have that do and have mortal effects on the community that is using this journal to kind of tease their way out of that psychic pressure. And it, where there is a difference between then and now is that artists have furthermore, I think, in the main, conceded that there is mortal power that surrounds them and that bolsters the work and bolsters their lives and at the same time could extinguish it. And that relationship to power back then is a kind of humor and kind of wittiness and a kind of, an elitism that comes from a developed intellectual cadre among a group of people that are familiar with a kind of universal language of physical demise as you die, you know. And is this work that we're doing now important in relation to the fact that there's the specter of war all around us, and that that in the coming years we're going to see massive amounts of people that will be destroyed essentially within 20-25 years, and the artists are on the ground, they're always on the street, you know, they're always both able to be with the true elite and at the same time be with the people, because they're the greatest artists can divest themselves from the people. And one of the differences, I would say, is that now you have, among the artists that we see and that we claim as a society, this is an artist, you know, that we say, oh, this person is an artist. They are more than willing to, at least ostensibly, divest themselves from the people and take on the wares of the elite and service them in a way that's almost obsequious, you know. And I think that's where the real difference lies, is that one group 100 years ago is in fear and makes fun of the elite from the shadows, and today the artists are in fear and they kneel before the elite.
That's a hard generalization. I mean,
that's a good one. I like that one.
I would say, obviously, with this, you're talking about a small cadre of people who did eventually become historically famous. I don't think that you would have a small cadre of people participating in the same way, even given, and especially given, the amount of access to media that they have, that could play the same way, and, you know, 50 years from now, 100 years from now, have the same kind of impact as such a small group did. I don't know if that's a generalization, it's a guess, you know, but from where I sit, that's what it looks like to me. And then I think, too, you think about New York at that time, New York was a relatively empty space, you know, compared to what it is now. It was just finding its legs as an artistic center. Paris is still the center at that point. Now New York is actually the center, and it is a brutal center for the vast majority of artists that are working today. I mean, in some ways you could look at and name 100 artists right now, but they make up a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of the people that are actually making work in New York City, right? And the thing that I would recognize with that small group is that they are more than happy to and willing to. I wouldn't say they're happy to, but they understand the mortal necessity to comply with the rules of the elite. And they're not playing as if they're not going to do that, where these people had the space to actually kind of pretend as though that they didn't matter. You know, that, yeah.
They kind of created a discourse around their own elitism, but they're actually super marginal. And you can tell the way this is printed, all kinds of things about just the paper they use. There's some ties to money through Beatrice Wood's father, but who was like, didn't want his name.
Well, actually, humanities, that's what they're supposed to talk about.
Right. So there was some connections to that, but the way that they position themselves as a kind of marginal elite is interesting in that respect.
I mean, I would too say that it's not like all hopeless in the sense that there are things happening. You know, there's films being made, there's videos being made, there are writers, there are people that are, you know, actively trying to do something, you know, on a certain level. And by do something, I don't necessarily fully mean, you know, political in the most common sense of it, but do something in the sense of bringing a particular kind of humanity to everyone, to everyone they have access to. I mean, I think too, which is something that's very interesting to me about that, you know, modernism and its development, its evolution, and particularly in you know, the early goings of the 20th century, I wonder how much they were looking back at things like, you know, like Goya, for example. Like, how did they look back? Are they looking back at, you know, a range of artists who, you know, were you know, concerned form and loved a good life, and as we all do, but also had really pressing matters that they had to deal with, and confronted those pressing matters in a way that was life-threatening, you know. I mean, I think, what's her name that wrote the New York School? What's her last name again?
Ashton.
Dori Ashton. That book in particular does actually kind of situate that time period, or just shortly after that time period, in a way that really puts people on the line, really folks you would never even imagine. I mean, all the abstract expressionists first generation, you know, they were in trouble. And much of that work is born out of a particular kind of trouble. You know, it's a resolution aesthetically to deal with the politics of the time that are influenced by government, et cetera, by powers, you know, by American power. But then you look at the evolution of abstract expressionism coming out of that pressure cooker to where it is now, and the work now seems a lot more empty, you know, in terms of what it's actually dealing with around it than if you look back at what those guys were actually doing.
Where do you think the shift happened?
What shift?
Hopeful to the hopeless. Like, in your sort of between then and now, when do you think it happened? Like, the shift?
I mean, I don't know. I did qualify that. I don't think it was completely hopeless. But I would say that whenever you have an excess of material good and a kind of open display of its concentration, and you can create means for gatekeeping to give access to that space, that's where you have a shift. I mean, I would think, you know, I would also, you know, say this is just my opinion, obviously all this is just my opinion, but you would say artists are, you know, relatively ambitious by habit, by nature. They're ambitious folks, so, and some of them are thoughtful and critical and cagey, but many of us will go for, you know, we'll go, we're like, oh, I have access now, so I'm going for that access. That means I have more volume, so I'm going to go for that more volume. And you have in America, and you know, post, you have West, post-World War II, that has had a huge amount of access and wealth and material goods, and like, so you would, it would seem obvious, you know, that would compromise certain values if there's this, just as much to have, and any, and the perception is everyone can have it, but in truth, you can't have that level of concentration, that expansive amount of power in one place without other people not having it. And artists are, I really do believe this, I mean, people that know me know I think this way, that artists are in a way kind of moral barometers. They there are reasons why there are people who are, there are artists who will not participate, and there are reasons why artists will participate, like, excessively. And we know who they are, you know, at least the ones that participate excessively, and we know where their work ends up. We know where their work ends up. And, you know,
it's interesting too in relationship to power and what the line is, and with like how humor can be born of it, and humor from a position of power is a kind of gloating, right? And so it's hard to hear. You can have this particular kind of activated critical humor, right? In all of, whether it's the picture hanger or Nina Boy's party text or this funny absurd play or whatever. There's and the editorials and all over the mom from Minneapolis. Like you have all this humor from a position of a kind of oblique relationship to power or like marginality or decision to stand slightly outside. I mean, it's an interesting place for which, I mean, it's, to me it seems cogent or that humor can emerge there, and it's very difficult for it to emerge in a palpable way from when the artwork is speaking from power, right? Because then it's like it's somehow standing above, right?
Well, the word emerge actually is interesting because it means that it's, you know, it was kind of under, you know, it came up. And actually, in an essay that I wrote about the work of Francesco Polanyi, I quote, you know, a very well-known statement of Duchamp from much later in the sphere, from I think 1961 or so, where he said, the great artists of tomorrow will go underground. And, you know, I point out that, well, actually, nobody did what Duchamp said, you know. Duchamp was the kind of prophet, in a way, of everything in the art of the 60s, and of pop, and of fluxes, and of all, you know, conceptual art, and so on. But very few people took his advice to lay low and let things come out, emerge later, to have that sort of, if you want to say, protected period of development or gestation among, you know, among that sort of small personal group. The other thing that I was thinking about as just a kind of addendum to what you're saying, or maybe it's a kind of tangent, but I think it's indicative, is that the American independence followed the French Independent Artists Association in taking on the slogan, no juries, no prizes. They had this, you know, that idea that everything was horizontal and the artist should just be able to put out what they felt they needed to put out, the public as individuals and not atomized individuals, but individuals in discussion with each other could respond to it and react to it, and they would like what they like, they wouldn't like what they wouldn't like, they would buy or not, okay, but the artist should just be able to put out whatever they needed to put out. And today, you know, I think we've completely accepted that no juries, no prizes, we don't believe in, it doesn't work for us. Where's the curator? Where's the curator? You know, and I say that as a curator of the show, but I think I didn't curate it, you know, from a sort of, with the idea of being in a position of being a gatekeeper or something, but in a way of just being able to show some things that I was interested in. But we've completely given in to the idea that there's a hierarchy of judgment within the art world that sort of shunts artists and everybody else into kind of different levels and different circles of prestige and so on. And the same question in a way, how did we go from no jury, no prizes to the kind of cult of the curator?
What seems hard about that is that, like, if Duchamp was right, if the greatest artists after that generation were to go into hiding, we don't know that's not true. Like, we don't know if the greatest artists aren't people we don't know about. It seems actually probably likely that they are. That, I mean, given the circulation of power, it seems likely that the greatest art that's been made ever, like, is the art that we don't know about in some ways. Like, there is some sense that we can only know the things that get the approval that make them wind up in front of us, right?
So, yeah, I do think that things get, you know, they emerge in time. And, you know, you can say, well, that's not provable. And I agree, it's not provable. But it's sort of, I think it's, you know, I can point to the fact that it's happened.
Of course, I mean, I think the thing I was trying to focus on was the question of scale. Like, we started the conversation with whether, like, one person could be a movement, or whether it needed to be extended to 300 people, or whether it needed to be so democratizable that it was likable by everyone, right? And I think all of us settled on some hope that there would be a small enough number of people who were enough distant from the elite that you could have the comfort of recognition of people knowable to you without the terror that they only knew you because of their power, right? I think that's how artists want to work, is with a sense of scale that's not just you liking it, but that isn't totally giving it to some broader judgment. And I think, like, one of the questions is, like, how many people is that? Should they be in the most expensive city?
Well, according to Jerry Schwabs, it's 7.
Yeah, that seems
amazing. I don't know if he counts as an authority in this room. Some people believe in him, and others don't.
Which one are
you? He said, I think, 3 collectors, 1 art dealer, and something else. He counts up to 7. Counts himself.
I say the hopeful part is that, I mean, the hopeful part for me, at least, is that, you know, artist is food, you know? I mean, and I think that's where the real danger in it, and how it's being treated is lies in the fact that it is a kind of sustenance and evidence of sustenance that is, you know, is relentless. It's just here. It's going to be here. It's going to keep coming. And so, who controls it, or like who serves the food? Who handles your food? You know, is always the real question, and that's a real question with actual food. You could imagine that with, you know, very, very expensive representations of the sustenance of art, which I think paintings and sculptures and objects are representations of art, not the actual art itself. And that's why many of the brilliant artists that we don't see don't make it. They choose not to. They have a completely different way of handling creativity. You know, I mean, and I think that's been being made evident slowly through current art world, where you're seeing things that are called art that actually you kind of question whether or not it's an actual artwork. It's utterly ephemeral, the idea is to take the beauty of artistic sustenance, share it ever so briefly, and then get it out of there before someone comes and contaminates the food. You know, like that's one way of thinking about it that is hopeful. And that's not to say that the painting or the sculpture or the object or whatever is not a beautiful thing or not a thing that, you know, that warrants existence. It does. I mean, I think the document is important. We need evidence, you know, like in a way, evidence is what gives us our legs, you know, to move forward. And I won't even say forward, I'll say to exist in a way with a kind of equilibrium, you know, not to be in complete state of vertigo, you know.
I mean, in the magazine, it's of course such a document. I mean, this is one of the reasons why we're doing this reprint. I mean, and Beatrice Wood is also a great example of someone who did not get the recognition or was at the time. She also exhibited a painting that was part painting, part ready-made. That you mentioned, she had there was a piece of soap stuck to where the fig leaf normally appears in a painting. And she was really, because everyone read it autobiographically, so she was clearly read as like this woman who's a nude or not quite a nude, so not taken seriously as an artist. So again, I think it's a great example of what we were talking about, someone who's emerging, well, only maybe 100 years later, gets the recognition. Also, her practice as a potter, again, that's clearly not as respectable as the kind of conceptual acrobatics of someone like Duchamp or other artists, so I think, yeah.
I just want to say, I also think that we're like the way we're talking about art, like with a capital A, is like we're talking about in a very narrow way, in a very sort of traditional way, and we're not really, we're talking about curators, museums, exhibitions, galleries, artists and critics. But I think, since we're here, since we're talking about magazines, I think we could also think much more largely about how the art world has evolved and changed since this time. And in particular in the 60s with the emergence of artist books, like this sort of direct action by artists to try to, not without its problems, but to try to engage with a more democratic means for distributing art into the world and for getting art into the world. And I think that, at least for me as a publisher, it's a kind of a milestone. And that's only one example of artists trying to get outside of the system that we're taking as a sort of given at this point. We had artists like intervening in magazines in the 60s, you know, like Harper's Bazaar, and like larger magazines, not just artist-driven magazines, but I think that there is like this other part of the art world,
yeah,
that we're sort of...
And I mean, I also think the Blind Man itself is a conceptual artwork.
I think it's Alternative Press, was the press in Detroit run by two people, maybe. Assemble an envelope every year, and they would put original artworks in it. And I remember Joe Brandon was going to do 300 drawings, but then he gave up after about 150 because he had to do 300 original works. So Ted Berrigan, I think, wrote 300 poems. And I remember Robert Feely saying, "This will fuck up my bibliographers. I'm going to write 300 have no record of them." And he wrote. And wrote 300 poems on postcards and sent it to them. And it was just kind of, you know, it was deliberate. I mean, he just was chuckling about this. And I think, and I have a lot of those envelopes. And, like, you know, every now and then, and they had posters in it, stickers, a lot of ephemera. It was meant to kind of be, just not be kept. But I'm one of those people that kept it, sorry. And I still have like original drawings by Alice Notley and stuff like that. It was kind of great. And it does give you a sense of, a real sense of a kind of community that you belong to where you would do this kind of gift exchange, that you would do 300, I mean, I did 300 fortunes for them and sent it in. And that you wanted to be part of this community, and it didn't matter if other people didn't know it existed. That it was just the exchange of these people, and I got to know some of the people through the magazine that I hadn't met them before and stuff like that. So I think that's, in a way, and I was thinking about this because I was just thinking about the show Venting Downtown. It was at the Gray Art Gallery when there was a lot of artists-run galleries. And as I was thinking about it, I was reading this piece that Tom Hess wrote shortly before he died. He said that art world changed in 1962. He said at one point everybody talked to everybody else, and in 1962, half the art world crossed the street so they wouldn't have to talk to the other half. He never really said why. My guess is he's thinking that collectors came in and divided the art world. But I thought it was an interesting notion that Tom Hess thought this and then would choose to write about it 15 years after it happened and kind of pinpoints his day. You know, like Monday morning, they stopped talking to each other. And I was like, I wish I only met him once, and I thought, God, if I'd known this article, I would have drilled you on it, you know, because he never really, I think he didn't want to name it, what exactly happened, because then people could disregard it and say that's not what happened. So he leaves it nameless, and there's this kind of hole in the article. But I think it's an interesting hole, because we do know that's true, right? We do know there are people that across the street and not talk to us. Well, I've experienced it, so. And I'm just a poet.
What if we democratize this?
Yeah.
In the spirit of democratizing, maybe we could take a couple of questions or ask people have comments that we don't have to answer as this specialist seven-person panel. And it's really open to any of you, and then we can reconvene also with drinks and snacks and talk more formally afterwards. But it would be nice to hear from the audience. We were promised something.
That's true.
If you guys have solutions to this question, a number, how many people does it take? What is the movement or this democratization question?
Yeah. Well, I think really important thing is when you say we, you have to recognize, I recognize the we that Duchamp was working in, which is a very different way from we now. And I feel like you tread on some very dangerous like universalist territory there, because like that we was very privileged and homogenous type of we, even though they were each themselves individuals and interesting and types of beliefs, intellectuals. They're just like the sampling of that group is still a very small sampling of the availability of the diversity of like a we. So like I think we needs to be defined and limited. It's not a universalist like us as like one might imagine. You know, now that our world is our worlds, it's not an art world. So I think like one of my favorite critics is Jose Esteban Munoz, who speaks about worlding and talks about kind of like subcultures and like how these are each worlds. And so I think like, you know, like what is this collection of pamphlets or writings or what have you to a world where it is not original to, like not native to, you know? So that's the one thing that I'm observing in this conversation. I'm just like what is the we? Because at one point, like, yes, like, there are a lot of things that this group was, but at the same time, like, it's all to make money. So, like, were they all, like, there's a kind of a resistance to actually describing who they were in, like, very deglorified terms. Because they are so, you know, they have been so effective in communicating these like their ideas. So it's like, you know, I mean, and I also come from a background of not really having researched Duchamp to everything. I mean, just understanding his like the effects, and also like moving part of it's also like, well, what is the necessity of all this kind of apocrypha when the effects of Duchamp are so deeply like installed, especially in the art world. So like, it's like, it's already here, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, does reading it enhance its here-ness, you know what I mean?
No, I think my intention was very much to actually dethrone Duchamp and to like instate more like the sense of that this is the work of a community, and to actually read Fountain as this conversation with a lot of different works, and that actually would not have maybe had the effect it had
had, you know, without the magazine or that community from which it emerged. That was personally my intention. I'm not interested in, or I don't even think that they are really establishing a kind of universal we of life. I mean, they might sort of posture in that way, but I think, I mean, I think it's precisely that problem that we tend to read art or like Fountain as if it might be representative, or like, or we read Duchamp. I mean, people keep saying, you know, it's Duchamp's magazine. It's not Duchamp's magazine. It was like a collective magazine, you know, that he can't, like, you know. But you know, you just can't help it. Like even the New York Times, when it says like whatever best art, or you know, it's like
it's not yes, your guys' effort.
Yeah,
it's
yeah, yeah.
To like giving a body to your film, and like a body that like needs to buy groceries. It's not like a body that
This is what I meant by starting by saying like a fantasy of democracy. If you imagine like who lived in New York in 1917, who made art in New York in 1917.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think there's any reason, I mean, I don't know enough to know whether to describe it as disingenuous, a magazine hoping for a fair that would really represent that, but it, I think we can be confident that that didn't happen, right? I think we know that there is a we unrepresented, even if there was a desire for the we to become large,
yeah.
Right? And I think that that is a question that feels like both present and different from the past in some ways. Like, the question of who's making what, when, and how it comes into the room, and who you describe was there.
Yeah, it was actually funny to me, because when Christopher said, well, you know, New York is a very much more open space then, and I know what you mean, and it, I think it's true in the sense you mean it, but somehow I thought to myself, yeah, but, you know, the Lower East Side was one of the most densely inhabited places on Earth in 1917. And so that wasn't a very, you know, there were open cultural spaces and very densely packed in population spaces. And that was all, you know, kind of part of New York at that time.
It actually seemed more popular than it is now because they used to have more labor here. The labor force was like that. It was much more.
I mean, there were just many more people packed into an apartment.
I feel like I might have seen. I went to the Museum of City York recently. I feel like there was something about how, like, at one point, actually, the population. I mean, I might be misremembering, but.
I think maybe one more thing, and then we can speak more.
The difference was, you know, 1917 New York. A lot of Europeans, roots, or roots in Europe, artists, and they saw each other in person probably almost every day because the habit of artists was to find a cafe where they would sit and talk. Talk about art, recite their poetry. And it was a habit that kind of went on for a long time, even in the 60s. You find Quentin Crisp in a cafe on 2nd Avenue every single day. You know, just something that I saw with my own eyes in the 80s. But with the advent of online communities, which I don't know what that is. Online community, you know, you don't touch each other, you don't see each other, you don't look into each other's eyes. How can you have a community without physical contact? And then that's what's the big difference between, you know, and you cannot create a movement if you don't wake up the entire society at once somehow, like the Dada movement, like the surrealism movement, like, you know.
But it's not just the online community. I think it's also what John was pointing to. I tend to think it's that, in a certain sense, the circulation of money in the art world is something that means that, you know, how can you afford to, you know, spend your time sitting around in a cafe, you know, gabbing about art when if you're not spending that hour in the studio, you're losing money that you could have done something.
Okay, so that's starting with Leo Castelli. Okay, and the tandem between Castelli and President Greenberg, I would say.
Well, you know, that inventing downtown show that John mentioned, which is a brilliant show, posited, I think, that it was really the opening of the Green Gallery by Dick Bellamy and backed by Roger Skull that really changed the scene, because that sort of drew some of the kind of most in the moment renowned and energetic artists out of that sort of downtown artist run gallery scene into the possibility of earning more money.
The dominance of money, you know, I think started with, you know, the power that Castelli had at one point. And remember, when he died, within a month, 300 galleries moved to Paris. Within 1 month after he died, that also tells something about, you know, the power that he had.
Should we end with power?
Yeah.
Let's end with beer.
Let's end with wine and beer, and please continue to mill around. The editions are for sale, facsimile edition, and also the little rich books suit separately, so take a look. Sarah will help you out.